responsible for distributed solar O&M for renewable power. This is all about the myself and Renew. I am going to talk because this forum is not about renewable power. This forum is about discussing the O&M aspect and issues. So topic mainly I am going to touch is O&M key challenges and the best practices, common types of module failure, and the remote monitoring. So this is the one question probably I am going to put in front of everybody. So what do you think? What should be the mindset of a developer? Answer from anybody? What should be the mindset of a developer? You can see the pictures also and correlate. I have put two examples, one for utility solar, one for rooftop solar. So in this slide, what I would like to bring it here, there is a mindset, change in mindset, drastic change in mindset in the developers because of the price war, which we all are witnessing these days. And ultimately what is happening, this I personally believe there is a compromise between the one-time cost of the project and the recurring cost. So I mean to say that we are more focused on the one-time project cost rather than the thinking long-term perspective and looking into the recurring cost which are going to be occur if we select the inferior project product. So where we should start O&M? In my view, we should start O&M from day one. I mean to say that from point we are thinking to design a project, there has to be input from the O&M, serious input, because we are the guy who is dealing on day-to-day basis with all the products and we know all the pros and cons, plus and minus of each and every product in detail. So from day one, O&M, in my view, O&M should involve to select a product. Now we can see this example for utility scale. What this picture shows? There are two pictures and these are projects in the Telangana and the Gujarat. I don't want to quote name here. So utility scale project, one is all works 15 megawatt, another is 10 megawatt. So because of saving one-time cost, we avoided as a developer, and when I quote we all comes in that. So we try to avoid a one-time land leveling cost, and we executed the project on the lower side of the land. And these two projects of 10 megawatt and 15 megawatt will be flooded for complete monsoon season, at least 3 months, three to four months, and there will be complete shutdown in the plant. We cannot operate the plant. So just imagine the cost. We saved 1 crore or we lost this 4 months for 25 years. The similar thing in next picture of utility scale, we try to save some of the drainage cost. And now what is costing us, because this plant is on slightly hilly, near hill, so water is, during every monsoon season, water is coming with full force and it is damaging most of the foundations, the civil structure foundations. And every year you have to repair in a 10 or 12 megawatt plant. Every year you need to repair after monsoon season at least 300 to 400 of foundations. And some of the structures get displaced, caused mechanical stress on the module, and there will be micro cracks in the modules. These are the consequences. Another picture you can see the rooftop. For rooftop, their selection of a roof is very, very important. We need to see the load bearing capacity of the roof. There is a race here again to do more and more, and roofs are less available, especially if you are doing the projects on the government sectors. Then you will find, really find, and some of the people can quote this. So some of the buildings are very, very old, and without doing a load-bearing test, if you will move ahead, you are putting the complete project on the risk. You don't know whether after 5 years, 7 years, 8 years, what will happen to these roofs. So this is another one of the important thing which I would like to brought it here. There are other challenges. I quickly move on, but one of the main challenges is the which other speakers also spoken about, module warranty. It's a real concern. This is not framed properly. What kind of reporting requirement if we are going to seek for module warranty? In the any of the warranty documents so far I have seen, it is not very clearly mentioned that in case of failure reporting, what kinds of dedicatedly report is required to get a warranty. What is happening when you report a problem, there will be endless number of document requirement will keep on coming from the OEM, and you fulfill one requirement, they will have another requirement, you will fulfill another, they will have one more requirement. So the buying contract and purchase agreement needs to be defined very clearly, where we need to add the generation loss clause also. In case there are two things, first we need to define which kind of reporting and how many reports is required really. Yeah, please put it on the full screen. So the module contract and purchase agreement should clearly define, one is the documentation part, what kind of documentation is required, and second is loss of generation clause also. So we already discussed whenever module failure is there, there is a logistic, they will take to lab, then they will test it, there is a testing time, then they will send it back to again site, and there is a logistic time. In this course of period, depending on the project size, we are losing lots of generation which is unaccountable and is being bearded by developer only. So there are some specific issues, other issues related to the rooftop basically. So net metering policies are there, but wherever we have these policies, there is a execution issues. So there are no timeline defined that how long it will take to do a net metering, close a net metering at any particular site. So there is no definition for this in any of the policies. Roof access, already one of our panelists has discussed about it. This is an issue in many cases. And roof access from, there are two aspects of it. One is from client side, and another aspect is safety also. Because sometimes to increase capacity on a particular roof, you may design a system and you may put the panels in area where it will be very, very difficult for a maintenance person to reach out. And this is completely unsafe. So if any accident is, I have seen some of the projects where PV modules are projecting outside the boundary of the your roof. So if any modules fell down on somebody, so there are safety aspect also for the maintenance person, as well as the, if you are putting plant in the public area, so that is also a safety concern. Response time for major OEMs. Problem is, I've seen in the contracts with the major OEMs like inverter and all, there is no SLA in many cases. If service level agreement is there, then also adherence is not there. So it must be backed up by PVG. But also, in my view, PVG standard as a standard 5% or 10% we are going to hold. But that is not going to serve our purpose. If as a OEM, I am going to take a risk on the 10% PVG and I will not adhere my SLA, then what I will do? 10% amount is very, very less for your projects. So this has to be backed up in properly. Then we will have the weather related issues, which is uncontrollable, that is not in our hand, like rain, fog, etc. Skill manpower availability for the remote location, that is also very, very challenged. Somebody has talked about the training. So you can put up a good technical person for some time in remote locations. But we all know we are not going to retain that person for long time. So kind of training institution we are running if you are putting plant in the remote locations and engineer at remote locations. They will remain there until they get trained and then they will move out. So we need to think why. This is the problem, but we need to think why they are moving out. So whenever we are putting a manpower at remote location, we have to take care of them. There has to be separate, in your HR policies also, there has to be some separate exclusions for those employees who are running at, working at the site. Just believe it, we are expecting from them, we are paying hardly anything, and we are expecting from those engineers to, in case of any breakdown, they can work whole night, but we have to take care of them. And they are working. They're sincerely working also. And this is the one main reason, because if they are not get paid accordingly, so we cannot able to retain them for long. So training and retaining, both part is very, very important. Then communication connectivity is one of the key aspect in the rooftop solar.
Mr. Brajesh, yeah. Can you conclude?
Yeah, give me 2 minutes because communication will be part which I am going to discuss. And vandalism at the public places. So that is also one of the challenges. These are the small basic things which we all know and follow, and we have all seen it. So I'll move around. These are the module problems. We already discussed different kind of module problems. But I'm not going to discuss these module problems. Why this is happening? In many cases, down the line somewhere, we have to accept it that it is because of us. During execution also, a mishandling we talked about. Why I have brought this slide here, there is a serious need of testing the plant or doing the due diligence of a plant immediately after the commissioning. There is a serious need of testing the plant, because then only we shall able to compare if I have the EL image from the manufacturer factory, and then if I am doing the EL imaging and the sample testing on the plant which is executed recently, I will able to make out whether this problem occurred, came from the factory, or whether this problem occurred during the execution. And believe me, execution is putting lots of issues on the, especially on the module. Due to mechanical stress, they will over-tight, misalignment, these all cause the micro cracks on the module. Need of data monitoring. So bunch of data is coming from the site. 25 million GB data created on daily basis. So getting only data is not the purpose. How to extract the required and desired information from that is the key. I just quickly run through one case study. So we are monitoring all of our distributed plant remotely from the centralized location from our head office. And we have even added the feature of getting module killing alert on inverter basis. So I can get an alert if any particular PV array on particular inverter is not killing. Inverter is not killing. So I'm getting the module killing alert from my portal on inverter basis also. I am following, I am getting the alert from breakdown, everybody is getting as a standard RMS protocol. But I'm getting a alert from inverter deviation, inverter to inverter deviation. So I'm comparing apple to apple. I'm not only getting the inverter to inverter deviation alert, I'm also getting an alert if 2 MPPT or 3 MPPT of inverter is not behaving same. So I'm getting alert if any deviation between the 2 MPPTs of inverter also. So this is one of the case strategy when we got the alarm, one of the MPPT was not working. Then we further drill down immediately to our portal. We observed that particular inverter number 5 is not working. We further drill down and went, we found the 1 MPPT voltage is problematic. We further drill down and we come to know that particular MPPT is bad. So same portal we reported to our OEM, and this is the reporting tool, the intervention. Same portal we have reported to our OEM, and there is a provision that once OEM will finish this task, he will have access a browser, he can put the reports and the updates there, and we will come to know case is closed. And we can count each cases with proper remote monitoring. And we have automated all of our reports. Not only the daily reportings, monthly reportings, revenue reportings, as well as the internal review reportings, all these reports are automated. Only in one cases where we need the IQ, there is a human interface that doing the loss analysis. Rest everything is automated for us. Thank you.